Fantastic. Thank you, Andrew, and the group that's put that together. That's great, great video. Let's pray as we think about this passage and think about what God is calling us to be and to do as a community together. Father, thank you. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for the chance to explore the scriptures, your word today. We pray, Lord, that you would speak to us. You would envision us. You would give us catch a sight of all you want for us. And we pray, Lord, come and work in our hearts, Lord, work in this community in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, our vision as a church, we've been here now just over 8 years as a church. We were a church plant from Holy Trinity Brompton, and there were kind of 10, 15 people who were here in this church when we arrived. They were going to close the church, and as they were going to close the church, the people who were members of the church said, "We do not want this church to close." And if you know them, some of the older members of the 930 congregation, they are a formidable bunch. You don't want to mess with them. And the bishop relented, and he went to Sandy Miller, who's the vicar of Holy Trinity Brompton, and said, "Would you be interested in planting a church here?" And through a process of discernment and agonizing and praying and thinking, and eventually just a very strong sense of being called, Louis and I and our family came with 95 other people from HTB. 80 people already lived in East London, and 20 people moved house, in some cases sold houses, to come and to be part of this new church community. And over the 8 years, we've grown. We've planted services, so we started the evening service, we started this service, and we have gone on to plant other churches in different parts of this borough. So St. Peter's Bethnal Green up in just the northwest corner of the borough, Adam and Heather took a group of about 25 people to go and graft into the group that's already there. And they're seeing growth and life and just making a significant impact on that community. A week later in 2010, Chris and Becky Rogers, who we recruited from Soul Survivor Harrow, they came and took a very much smaller group of 8 to 10 people from here over to Bow to restart that church. There were just 7 people left in that church. And I think in the last few Sundays, they've been having 120 people coming to worship on Sundays, which is a fantastic thing. That's one of the most challenging areas in Tower Hamlets, where St. Clement's Hospital, which was a mental health hospital, was closed a few years ago. And many of the people who were the people of that hospital now live in the community. It's huge mental health issues in that area. But that church is again reaching out to the area in partnership with Eden, who are an incarnational church ministry group that are reaching out particularly to young people. It's a fantastic thing there. And then 2 weeks ago, St. Luke's Millwall started, and it's a new initiative. Again, there was a group of people who were already worshipping there, but we were invited by Christchurch Isle of Dogs to come and send a group from here, and we've sent 20 adults, 15 children to go and join that community there, and they're in their second week today. They have their services at 10:30, and that's so exciting. It's that new work on the Isle of Dogs, beginning to reach out in a new and transforming way to their community. And so, as we kind of, as we begin to, having done all that activity, just particularly recently in planting our third church, it's time to consolidate. It's time to regather ourselves and to begin to think through actually who are we, what are we about, and hence this series, We Are SPS. We're going to be touching this year on this in a few ways. We've got this vision series of 3 weeks now. In May, I'm going to be preaching through the values of St. Paul Shadwell. About what, as we've in our ninth year, as we begin to think, who are we? What are we about? You know, what are the things which underpin us as a church? And then in September, we'll do another vision series, particularly as new people come in. But one of the things about vision is that people say vision leaks, and we need to keep on reaffirming the vision that God has called us to. And over the years here, God has reaffirmed again and again what we're about. We are here to see Shadwell and East London transformed by the love and the power of Jesus. That's what we're about. But what does transformation look like? Transformation looks like a community of people who have been touched by the power and the love of God. A community that begins to behave differently to the way that the world behaves. A community that is attractive to people, where marriages are healed and restored, where families are brought back together again, where people's lives are turned around, where the pain and brokenness of every one of us begins to get healed, where we see the unjust things around us beginning to be changed. You know, I keep on coming back to it. It's touched me very deeply. But the number one, it's now actually number two, child poverty in the country, in terms of wards experiencing this, is just across the road here in Shadwell. You know, how are we going to see that change as a community of people here, are kind of praying and working for good? And the way we have we kind of work out this vision of seeing transformation is by making disciples, of transforming these communities, and of planting churches. That's our kind of means of operation. And today, just using this passage, I want to explore what kind of community God is calling us to be. I was just thinking, as I was thinking about community, church communities and so on, actually that one of the newest communities around is the online community. And, you know, there's some very positive things about the online community. It's enabling relationships to happen regardless of race or religion or gender or geography. It's pulling people together from all over the world, completely different people meeting each other, kind of online. But along with that, there are masses and masses of issues that are just beginning to come to life. Someone described it as like two hula hoops that kind of come together. One is like a hula hoop of real life, and the other is a hula hoop of a virtual life. And in the past, these two hoops have been separated. You know, we have our real life, real body, real interactions. And then there's this kind of, this virtual life that you can deal with, where you're projecting something else on the internet. But now these two hula hoops are kind of coming together much, much more, and they're becoming confused. There's sometimes no distinction between the face-to-face and the virtual. In the face-to-face, we can see each other, we can test each other, we can know each other. In the virtual, we don't know each other. We can project something that we're not. And so this is the beginnings of some of the issues that people are beginning to find. So, for example, identity, the forming of identity. It can be very, very ambiguous in this mix of real life and virtual. Who actually are we? You know, we can create an electronic personae that is completely different to us. So what that creates is a lack of trust. As I engage with someone who I'm kind of reading about or communicating with, who actually are they? You know, they call themselves John, but they might be a woman. They come across as someone who is very intelligent and wise and so on, but actually they might be a child because of what they're communicating. They're projecting this thing. How can we trust personal or professional information? One of the things that people are beginning to discover with people who are spending more and more time on the internet is the problems of preoccupation, of distraction, of detachment, of desensitization. We see that with our own children. I find that with when I'm just working on, you know, writing talks or whatever, or just doing emails, I'm so focused that on that that I'm not able to engage with some things in my family sometimes. Desensitization. One of the things that online gaming can create. And it's becoming more and more of a problem where people, particularly in the under 35 bracket, are spending hours and hours in online gaming, particularly men. And there are all kinds of problems with these online communities where harassment is becoming more and more of an issue. So I came across terms like trolling. Have you heard of trolling? Trolling is displaying hostility by insulting and swearing and using offensive language towards people on the internet. Cyberbullying is willful, repeated harm inflicted from one person to another. People experiencing this on phones and so on, but also on in internet chat rooms and so on. And there is a lack of real social interaction. So spending too much time online means, you know, you lose your ability to interact with people face to face. I was interested in something that Zoe, our daughter, said, which is that, the practice more and more is that people will check, you know, they'll see someone at school, they'll check them out on Facebook first, and then they'll meet them face to face. It's interesting. You're making all your preconceptions about someone from what they're projecting in this online arena, rather than actually how you interact with them face to face. So with that new community around us, the challenges and problems that creates, actually that's affecting all of us. What is the community Jesus is seeking? Well, the first thing we see in Jesus' words here is that we are to be a missional community. Jesus says to the disciples, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." It's quite a lot of authority. He says, "Therefore, as a result of this authority that I am commissioning you, the disciples, the followers of me." The first thing is to go. To go. The Latin word is associated with this is mitto, which means I send. Hence the word missional. Missional comes from that Latin word mitto. I send. Jesus says go. He's sending his disciples into the world. So we are to be a community of people who aren't introspective, not retreating, not hiding, but a community that is mobile, that is on the move, that is outward facing, that is going to where other people are. What are we to go and do? We are to be those who embody what Jesus was about. Jesus' work was to do the will of his Father. The will of his Father, Jesus says, is this: God so loved the world that he gave his Son, one and only Son, that whoever might follow him and believe in him might have eternal life and not perish. We are a sent community. We exist not for ourselves, but actually for those who aren't members here. That's why it's so important for us to not just to be a community of people, not just come to church, but actually to be involved in our communities. That's why we want to see our communities transformed, because we are to go to them and begin to bring the love of Christ to these communities. That's why we're interested in Shadwell, not just in building up this church. We're interested in Shadwell. We're interested in East London, the places where you live. Jesus calls you to go to where other people are. So, we've just planted our third church. These are parish churches that we're planting. But I think we need to continue to plant, but not necessarily just parish churches, but planting into other places where people don't come to church. So, for example, in schools, in cafes, in community places, on housing estates. One of the things that I keep on, that kind of grips me, is that when you do the statistics, there are 4,000 people in our parish. That's kind of stretching from a couple of roads that way to the Limehouse Basin over there, from the river up to Cable Street. 4,000 people in this area that is, that this church has responsibility for. It's, we look wider than that, but specifically that area. Of the 4,000, there are no other churches in our area, no other groups that meet as Christians in this parish. So let's be generous. Let's take, 100 people, say, who live in our parish, who are part of this community. I think it's a bit less than that. 100 out of 4,000 is 2.5%. 2.5% of people are Christians in this area. Some of them might go to church, so let's say other people might go to other churches, so let's say it's 3 or even 4%. What about the other 96%? How are they going to hear the gospel? Even if we give them fantastic invitations, if everyone invited someone from our parish to come to church, then we would hit, and they started coming, then we would hit maybe 8%. Of this local area. But what about the 92%? You see what I mean? We've just got, there's so many people who need to experience the love of God. And so we need to go to them. So I don't know how that's going to happen, but we need to start thinking, not just parish churches, but with our connect groups and with other groups who are saying, actually, let's start something in that place. Let's go in my block. I'm going to intentionally start praying for the people in my housing estate or in my gated community, wherever it is. I'm going to start praying for them and seeing those people come to know Jesus, come to know his love. We need to go to where people are. Louis and I have just spent a week in America, and we were invited to go and speak at the Anglican Mission in the Americas Winter Conference. And this is one of the, in the Episcopal Church, that's the Anglican Church in America, there have been various kind of challenges as it's gone more and more liberal, away from the traditional understanding of what it means to be a Christian. And so a lot of the churches have said, actually, we want to step out of where that's heading. We want to come back to orthodoxy. And so we were with one of these groups. And the Anglican Mission in the Americas is a church that is, or a group of churches, is a mission that is defines itself by saying, we're going to plant new churches in America. Well, that's what we want to do. And so they've planted 200 churches already over the last 10 years. And it was just amazing to see a group, they were kind of redefining themselves in the conference that we were at, just saying, actually, this is the most important thing. We mustn't get caught up in kind of the issues of kind of church stuff, and the church has become so disunified in America. And they were saying, we need to focus on what is the most important thing of all, which is actually we need to help others to discover Jesus. We need to help people to know this living relationship. And it was great. They love you guys, because we were telling them about who you are and what you're about. And they just thought, you are amazing. So there you go. AMIA, it's called, the Anchor Mission in America. To be a missional community is never to stay still. We must never be satisfied with where we are. We need to constantly think, actually, we have something which is so precious that it needs to be given away. I want to just reaffirm some of the things we said right at the beginning of the year and last year as well, which is keep praying for your neighbors. Keep praying for your colleagues and your friends in your workplaces, in your communities, in the schools, wherever it is. Keep praying. You might have a list of, 7 people, 10 people that you just say, okay, these people don't know the Lord. I'm going to pray for them. I'm going to say, Lord, please give me ways to that they can relate to, that are going to be ways they can hear about God. But also, may other people share their faith as well with them so that they can discover it for themselves. We need to pray for ourselves for boldness. Because, it's more and more, as you know, it's more and more difficult in our society. People are so cynical. People are so misunderstanding of what the Christian faith is about, of who Jesus is. That when we do share our faith, people ridicule us. Zoe is one of the only Christians in her class. And she gets so much flack sometimes for being a Christian, yet she's bold. She's prayed for boldness. And that's something we must do. We must pray for that boldness in the spheres of influence that we exist in. We're to be a missional community. Secondly, Jesus says, go and make disciples. Make disciples of all nations. So we are to be a purposeful community. We have a purpose. God has given us a purpose, not just to be disciples, but to make disciples. This is one of the big paradigm shifts that I'm kind of going through at the moment. There are steps, aren't there, of coming closer and closer and getting more and more involved in a church community. The first one, I think, is just coming, just attending, just kind of being a part of things. And more people are beginning to say, actually, I want to belong to a community, and then I'm going to come to believe in what this community stands for. I want to belong to a community that I think this is a community that's worth belonging to. They seem nice people, they're great people. And as people experience that community, they begin to believe, they begin to follow Jesus. So just turning up to this community is the first stage. And that's something we want to encourage. And so this community, this church community, will always be have a mix of people, some who aren't Christians, some who are Christians. And we want to welcome everyone into this community so that everyone may come forwards closer in their relationship with God. So that's the first shift, is actually coming. Then there's another shift of moving from being an attender to being a believer. And that's, you know, we mark that, don't we, by baptism, where we say, actually, I want to be baptized. I want to publicly acknowledge that I believe in Jesus. I want to follow him. Belief. But, you know, you can be a believer, but you can be a private believer, and no one else will know about it. So the next shift is to move from private Christianity to a more public faith. It's beginning to say, actually, I am called to share my faith with others. I'm called to be a light in the world. I'm called to be salt of the earth. Jesus said, don't cover up your light under a bushel, under some kind of a bowl. No, it needs to lift that off so it can shine out. We are to be public in our faith. That requires courage, and we need to keep on asking for that. But God calls us to that, the next shift. But there's another shift still, which is to say and to be obedient to Jesus' command here, to make disciples. It's one thing to be a disciple, but to make disciples is another shift altogether. Jesus says here, well, he doesn't say, go and be disciples. He says, go and make disciples. To make a disciple, I think, starts here. It starts with us taking responsibility for one another. One of the things about the Enlightenment from the 16th, 17th centuries is that people began to think about themselves and defining themselves by who we are. So Descartes said, I think, therefore I am. But actually, we are not to think in that way. We are to think more like this. I think, therefore you are. You see the difference? Or you think, therefore I am. You know, we are to define ourselves by one another and not by ourselves. We are a community that takes responsibility for each other. So we are to say to one another, I want to help you to be a disciple. I'm going to take responsibility for you. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to build you up. I'm going to share the scriptures with you. I'm going to teach you, and I'm going to learn from you. I'm going to make a disciple of you. And when we all do that, that kind of responsibility makes a massive difference. People begin to love each other in completely different ways. People begin to treat each other differently. It becomes more than a community that just meets an hour and a half on a Sunday morning. Becomes a community who are concerned for one another. That's where it starts. But if you think all of us before, you know, if you've always been a Christian, that it's slightly different. But with if you have come to faith in your life, before you came to faith, you can see moments where God has been working in your life. You can see moments where other Christians have encouraged you and actually helped you in your walk of faith. Discipleship starts before we become Christians. So all of us who know people who aren't Christians, we are, as we make disciples, we are to start with the people who don't know Jesus. There's something called the Engel scale, which is a measurement that evangelists use to show how far people are on their walk with Jesus. And it starts at minus 15, and I think goes to plus 15, and conversion is naught in the middle. And minus 15 are people who are just completely no understanding of God whatsoever. And as you get closer, people's understanding changes until they come to that point of conversion. And then it's good to know the journey doesn't stop there. It keeps on going of discipleship. Now, wherever we are, making disciples is helping someone to go from minus 15 to minus 14. Minus 14 to minus 13, minus 13 to minus 12. And what part are you going to play in that? It could be just a little nugget that you feed someone. It might be an act of love, of generosity that you express to someone. This 40 days of generosity, this kind of thing. Check it out, 40acts.org.uk. It's a great thing to be doing during Lent. 40 acts of generosity, one a day. But you know, take that up and just do it with the people that are around you, so that those people can come to faith. Discipleship starts at minus 15. Making disciples starts at us, helping those people to move forwards. And then, of course, it doesn't stop there, it continues. I think more than that, there might be some who we need to take special responsibility for. In families, it's obvious. We're to make disciples of our children. But actually, where are the children of faith in our congregation? Are there people who are younger than you, who you can disciple? Are there actually people who are older than you in the faith, who you can say, would you make me more of a disciple? Will you help me? Discipleship, a purposeful community. That's why this year we're making a special year of, you've seen it on this branding, Invest 2013 is a year of discipleship. We want to get this under our belt in terms of this is part of the DNA of this church, to invest in one another, to see us becoming better and more effective disciples of Jesus. So whether you're a lawyer, whether you're a shopkeeper, a student, a mother, an accountant, a banker, a sailor or a soldier, a nurse, a doctor, whatever profession, whatever calling you have, you are to be one who makes disciples. Think, just even now, think of the people who you spend significant amounts of time with each day, in your working life or in your home life, wherever it is. Jesus says those are the people who you need to make disciples. And you might not see them come to faith in the time that you're with them, but you can help them in their walk of discipleship as they get closer to faith. We're to be a purposeful community. Thirdly, we're to be a welcoming community, baptizing them, Jesus says, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Jesus calls us to baptize. So baptism is an outward sign of an inward and spiritual grace. That's the definition. So baptism, when someone is baptized, that's an outward sign of something that's happening or has happened on the inside. It's a sign that God is at work in someone's life and that something has profoundly changed. It's a sign that a new beginning has happened, a new creation has happened. It's a celebration of conversion, a celebration of life, of change. It's an acknowledgement that, particularly amongst adults, but for children, it's done on their behalf, that they have turned away from a life without Jesus towards a life with Jesus. It's repentance. It's repenting of the things of the past and of a life away from God to turning towards a life of God, a life influenced and filled by God and his what he's about. It's a life of change. So Jesus, when his first words when he started ministering age 30 were, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. Repent. Repentance, metanoia, means a 180-degree change from where we were heading before to where we need to be heading. Baptism marks that change. We are to baptize. And so we're to introduce people to Jesus. We're to introduce and help people to make that change. It's God who enables that change to happen, but we are caught up in being part of that. And Jesus says here that we are baptized into the name of in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the Holy Trinity, the Godhead, three persons, one God. In God's very nature, he is Trinity. God's very nature, he is community. In God's very nature, there are loving relationships happening already. And so when Jesus says you're baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you're baptized into this community of the Godhead. You're baptized into the way that community works. The loving relationships of submission and mutual love. That is what we are welcomed into by Jesus when we start this spiritual life. So this is the life that is to be part of our community. We are caught up in the relationships of God. So that's why we want to affirm love so much. That's why we want to connect with the love of God so much, because it is so powerful. It is so different. It's so much what we need. That's why welcoming is such a high priority in our church. When someone is given a welcome on the door, if you're involved in that welcoming ministry, it's such a brilliant thing, because you're welcoming someone in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You're expressing that love just in saying hello. You're expressing that love if you serve a cup of coffee and give it to someone. You're expressing that love as you meet someone and greet them and say hello. You're expressing that love of the Trinity when you introduce them to someone else, when you help them settle. Every part of that welcoming ministry involves what this is getting to. Introducing people into the love that exists in God. We are to be that community. One of the things that, one of the people who has touched our hearts here is Karina, who many of you will know. Karina used to live down the road here. She's now back in Sweden, where she comes from. And Karina wasn't a Christian when she came here. She had had a painful divorce. And it was so painful in her life that she had left her children in Sweden, left her job, had a good job, and left her friends to kind of flee here. She was trying to just get out of this extraordinarily painful situation. She came to live on the highway. And one day she was just walking past the church and she saw someone in the church smile at her. Someone smiled. And so she came in to, there was some activity in the churchyard. From that moment, she began to encounter the people of this community. And in her words, she encountered loving relationships. And she experienced that love herself. She got involved in gardening just because she just liked hanging around these people. And there was a moment where she said she was invited to come in, and she came in. And she used to sit right at the back corner, and there was a sofa there. And she said that every time the music started playing, she started crying. She said it was a good kind of crying. But she experienced a healing in her life day after day, week after week, as she came here and got to know the people of this community. There are some close friends who were loving her and encouraging her and discipling her. Until eventually she felt she was ready to go back to Sweden. She's now there. She's part of a fantastic church. She's back with her children. She has a good relationship with her divorced husband now. And her life has been turned around. She has experienced that metanoia, that repentance of heading in one direction and turning to the other. But she did it through this loving community. The love of this community helped heal her, helped see her change. And she has come to faith. She has experienced that baptism process in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. A welcoming community. Missional, purposeful, welcoming. And finally, Jesus calls us to be a learning community. Jesus says, we're to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. We are to be those who teach disciples everything that Jesus taught. Someone said recently to me, if you stop learning, you stop living. And one of the things that personally I've found just over the last 5 years, I've learnt, I think, more that I have in lots of different stages of my life. I've just been so energised by learning about things like discipleship, about churches, church planting and so on, mission. And God has fired me with this desire to see this grow and grow in the church. So as we make disciples, we are to encourage one another to obey Jesus. Obedience-based discipleship. We are to obey the commands of God. What are the commands of God? Well, summed up, Jesus said, the summary of the law and the prophets is to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. Two great commands, to love God, to love your neighbor as yourself. And then he introduced a third great command, the new command, is to love one another. At the Last Supper, he said, love one another. So that's part of what we're about. We are to love God, to love our neighbor as ourselves, and to love one another. Love is at the heart of the Godhead, but it needs to be at the heart of this learning community. We need to learn to love. We will get it wrong. We are fallen human beings. We won't love as we need to love, but we need to learn to love. There'll be many times when we will hurt each other, but we need to learn the art and the language of love, of forgiving each other, of being honest with one another, of actually preferring one another, of letting go of self and submitting and loving the people around us. What is the best thing for them? What is the best thing for you, not for me? Loving one another. And this love is just a huge thing that it is not easy to do. It's much easier to look after number one. But we are to be that loving community where we cultivate loving God in our worship times together. We cultivate worshiping God alone in our devotional lives, of reading the scriptures and praying each day, of cultivating that love for one another. That is best done in connect groups. As this church community grows, particularly as we've planted and different people begin to start leaving because we're sending them to different places, we need to consolidate what happens on Sundays in midweek groups. And we want to encourage every single person to be part of a connect group if they possibly can be. If you can't be, let us know. We want to try and find a group that you can belong to, because it's in a group that you can, a smaller group, that you can begin to do those interactions. You can begin to love and be loved. You can begin to disciple and be discipled. You can begin to start seeing, actually, how does this work in practice? Join a connect group. If you're not in a connect group, fill in one of those cards, blue connect card, and we'd love to help you connect into a group that's going to work for you. How do we encourage this obedience? Well, this obedience comes by being open to it, by being taking that posture of saying, I need to learn, I need to be taught. It means we need to take a posture of humility and not arrogance. We need to submit to the word of God, not to kind of push it to one side. And actually that means in practice that we need to help each other. We need to disciple each other. We need to teach each other. We need to be pressing in to this more and more. In America, when we went from Charleston to Greensboro, where this conference was, and we were driven by two guys. They were called Shay and John. Shay and John, both businessmen, they'd taken some time off their businesses to go to this conference. And it was fascinating. Just the journey was supposed to take 4 hours and took us 5.5 because we kept on getting distracted and going on wrong routes. And iPhones don't always take you on the right routes as well. So, but that meant that we were able to have a fantastic time together. And these two people they were part of a church called St. Peter's Mount Pleasant. It was a new church, been going for about 2 or 3 years. And these people had been changed as a result of being in this church community. Shay had said that, you know, he'd been brought up as a Christian, but his encounter with this Christian community meant that he'd started being involved in discipleship in a way that he'd never been before. Begun to start discipling those around him, taking responsibility for those around him. John, this other chap, was an amazing man. He was a manager in a retail outlet. And he just said that he had been through a really, his parents had been through a painful divorce. And that affected him in his life. That was when he was 9. And he'd always kind of pushed people away. He was married a few years before, and he had 3 children. And he just said, as a result of being in this community, this Christian community, and he was relatively new to the faith, he had begun to experience healing in a way that he had never had before. He spoke openly and honestly about some of the difficulties that he had in his life. That he said, I never would have done that before. I would have just closed up and held it back. He experienced love through his small group in his church and this loving community. It was clear, and he said, you know, I've got a long way to go. But here was a place where he was beginning to experience that kind of love and acceptance and healing. As we grow in our discipling of one another, as we grow in our loving of one another, we will see a change. We will see our church community be transformed. We will see a community that not just is just fantastic to be a part of, but is one that begins to shine to the communities around us. It'll shine to people who are longing for love. If you don't have your identity in God, you're putting your identity in things that are never going to satisfy you. Augustine said, our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you, talking about God. So we want to encourage in this year, if you like a consolidating year after planting again, to foster this community. This community, this church community, to be a community that is missional, that is outward facing. We're not satisfied with where we are. We want to keep on moving, but we particularly want to be outwardly facing. We want to be that community that has a purpose to make disciples, not be satisfied with just coming and just kind of having a front, but actually saying, I want to be discipled by you. I want to disciple you and others here, and not just in this community, but discipling everyone everywhere, so that people can take those steps closer and closer to the Lord. We want to be a community that is welcoming, baptizing new believers, but also expressing the love of relationships in the Trinity, welcoming new people, welcoming people to encounter that extraordinary love. We want to be a learning community. It's like we've all got L plates on. We are learning to love. We are learning in the mistakes that we make and in the as we fail, actually, that we're not prepared just to stay in that place. We want to get up, dust ourselves down, ask for forgiveness and keep going and keep loving and keep learning to be followers of Jesus. Discipleship is a lifelong journey. We will have L plates on all the time, but we need to just keep on going. The biggest encouragement, I think, about this passage is in that last sentence. Having commissioned them, Jesus says this, "Surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." We cannot do this without Jesus. If Jesus hadn't put that last sentence in, it could have easily been interpreted as being, okay, we just got to keep going and keep going, and we're going to try until we get to heaven, and that's the way it is. But instead, he says, "I'm with you always." His Holy Spirit, who is called the Paraclete, is the one who, that means he's the one who comes alongside us. He walks with us. He fills us. He helps us. He energizes us. He enables us. So this year, as we think about what we are to be, let's be this community that is a discipling community, that is a purposeful, missional, welcoming, learning community. Let's stand, shall we? And let's pray.